So we're here tonight, Sustainable CT Committee meeting, June 17th at 6 p.m. So we'll start right away with Mark Morgan, and then you with the food waste up.
My name is Mark Morgan, I'm not admitted.
Oh, you want to introduce ourselves around? Or?
Sure.
Okay.
Hey, I'm Justin Rianto.
I'm Brenda Kincaid. I'm Sue Mudd.
Jen and Boy.
Julie, my wife. So I'm here in wear two hats on this. We live in Columbia, so we're interested in doing what we can to help waste reduction model in the community. And food waste is really, when I sent that email earlier, it's kind of the next frontier of waste diversion. Columbia does a really good job with an effort that it does at the transfer station. We participate in it. When we don't do curbside, we reduce our waste to such a level that curbside actually doesn't make sense for us. It would be 2 months probably before we fill the curbside car. So it just doesn't make sense to do that. And there's a lot of people at transfer stations in Moncton. But food waste is the next option. And there's a couple of, there's several areas that could be explored. And the first one, like I mentioned, is backyard composting. And you know, a lot of people do backyard composting and want to get more people to backyard compost because backyard composting is the least cost option and most environmental option when you're getting for food waste management. You're managing it at your home, you're using it at your home, it's composted. So it's got a very low carbon footprint. The cost is negligible because you're not taking it in the dump. The next option available is a drop-off location. And we just started that. We've been talking to several communities who are trying just what I refer to as low entry points to food waste diversion. And a drop-off location helps those who, you know, might not be able to because of space or time constraints, or they don't understand it. Backyard composting is a great option, but it's really not something to just enter into lightly. Not that it's really complicated because it's not. People get really jammed up about it and generally do it wrong. You talk about bears or raccoons and things like that. We no longer explain what we do, what our small model. I've been backyard composting. I've managed compost facilities over the last 35 years. I've never had anything in my box. One of the largest facilities I managed, we took in almost 4,000 tons a year of food waste. We didn't have bears, coyotes, digging in the piles. It's managing it correctly and managing odors, things like that. You don't have problems. But if you do it wrong, we can invite some of those creatures. So a drop-off location helps kind of mitigate that. It's a pretty low-cost option. We're doing a two-yard dumpster at Wyndham. The idea is residents, and I know the demographics are quite a bit different in Wyndham than Columbia. In Wyndham, the focus is a lot of multifamily housing just doesn't have access to food waste diversion. So the idea is you place the dumpster at the transfer station, people use compostable bags, put their food waste in compostable bags, place it in the dumpster, and then Casella will pick that up on a weekly basis. That material would then be transferred to a facility actually in Southington, where they produce electricity from the food waste, and then whatever's left after they've extracted energy from that is composted on site. In some, so it is a waste diversion option. It's not composting. It's a different way of managing the things. Then the third method that we use in our home is a basically an appliance about the size of a small microwave oven or a Keurig machine. Ours is in our kitchen, but we don't have a lot of appliances in our kitchen. And what this device does, it grinds and dehydrates your food scraps. And what you're left with is literally a powder. And I apologize if I thought we were going to get into the weeds like this time. It would have just brought it from home. It produces a powder and then it runs through the night, basically grinding up and dehydrating the material. And the next morning, you just throw it on the lawn. And some folks are like, well, doesn't it smell? Haven't you encouraged critters to come to your house? And we have not had that experience at all. In fact, it's allowed us to not have to take our trash out as often. Because a lot of times, the reason we take out our trash is really because it smells bad. Mm-hmm. And we're trying to get the odor away. So the food cycler allows you to do all sorts of food scraps except for beef bones. So we did our entire Thanksgiving dinner with family. We really geeked out and brought the food cycler with us for the family gathering. And just to see what that would look like. And we ended up collecting probably a quart size of food scraps. And we had put portions of the turkey carcass in and grinds up bones and eggshells and everything. And then you just have this, it's about a half a Ziploc bag was left after Thanksgiving. So that's an option too. And there's a cost for that that's borne on the individual. And again, some of the benefit of that is, again, it's for those who don't have space for backyard composting and would really like to reduce their, the impact. We've done a study on transporting the food waste to Southington compared to food cycling.
He wants
to
and
the food cycler is a lower carbon footprint than placing in the dumpster and delivering it to Southington. Obviously, it's not the 45 minutes away fast. This material, it's like backyard compost. You're generating your home, managing your homes, you're getting rid of it at home. So
someone would need the machine to do that.
You need the machine to do that. And it's about $20 a month lease.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a subscription program for that particular.
There's
a lot of other ones in there. We looked at a lot of other appliances, and other appliances require additional enzymes, frequency of filter changes, simplicity of use, variety of material that it would accept. This is what we came with. We're actually partnering with UConn. UConn is using them in several of their residential life buildings, as well as sat lounges, as a way to reduce waste, because it's hard to, in certain areas, it's hard to aggregate that material into meaningful to reduce the impact. So UConn, they'll have about 25 minutes
on the campus.
And it's for sat lounges, not for him. We collect food waste from here in a different fashion. We have totes and things like that. Curbside collection of food waste on a residential level, just for those who are thinking about that as an option, it's really not a viable option. The cost per stop is quite high because what you're picking up is pretty minimal. And to bring a truck down the street is, there is that's a fixed cost. So to bring a truck down the street is, X dollars, no matter how many people are on that street. So that's a fixed cost. And then you're picking up only a portion of what you're actually throwing away for your garbage. So the cost for food scrap collection is typically unattractive. It can be twice what it costs you to get rid of your trash. And so very often it's why am I going to pay $50 a month to have somebody can pick up my food scraps? I'll just throw it away in the trash.
Mm-hmm.
So some things that are on the horizon with food waste in Connecticut is, you know, there are some bills that are being presented right now that require municipalities to develop food waste management plans, how we're going to convert food waste. I think by 2028, something like that. There is a food waste diversion requirement in Connecticut. If you produce half a ton a week of food waste, that that applies to, I don't think, anyone in Columbia. There's no food manufacturing in Columbia.
So that's like for energy, right?
Correct. Yeah. So like the school isn't large enough to produce that much food waste. You would need at least 150 students in a building, you know, that are serviced by a cafeteria to get out of that food waste on a weekly basis. So it's just, there's no entity that is required to divert the food waste. There's a threshold, I don't know if it's really a threshold. If you're more than 20 miles from an entity, in Connecticut, you're not required to divert. So Eastern Connecticut, there's actually nobody in Eastern Connecticut that needs to divert it because the closest facility is in Southern. So there's all this talk in Connecticut about diverting food waste, but there's virtually no infrastructure to divert food waste. You'll hear a lot about Connecticut has a 500,000 tons of food waste available to divert, and we have capacity for about 60,000 tons. The other anaerobic digesters that people talk about, there's one in Coventry, that was built for liquid manure. They do take some liquid food waste from the facility in Southington, but they're not receiving food waste from individuals or businesses directly. It's going first to what's known as a deep packaging facility to have the food waste kind of removed from the packaging, things of that nature, and prepared for anaerobic digestion. So the available infrastructure in Connecticut is quite limited, but there is a huge desire to divert food waste. And so for us as a company, that was where we picked up food cycling, really was. Transportation is the biggest limiting factor to get food waste where it needs to be, as well as an understanding of how to appropriately backyard compost. Encouraging individuals to manage their food better is a great start. You know, the whole food use, reuse, and recycle is a great way to start food waste reduction programs. Backyard composting, again, is cheap and encouraging people to do those, but frankly, if who in this room is doing backyard composting? And this is sustainable Columbia. Now, if you ask the same question to those who attend town meeting, it would not be 90% of the people in the room. So this is preaching to the choir, essentially. The majority of the people out there like the idea of backyard composting, and I'm a proponent of backyard composting. People can do it and do it well. That's the way that we should be managing food waste. We should be keeping local, managing locally, not shipping it out. All the food waste programs I managed were just like that. We managed it locally. The material we generated, we utilized locally. It was all keeping everything as close to the site of generation as possible. So I mean, that's kind of where food waste is. It's a lot of information, but those are the three kind of basic options as I see them today. There's a lot of talk about grants coming out of Connecticut DEP. There's several communities who have taken advantage of that. We question the validity of the options that are being presented. Some communities are trying something called co-collection. Again, it's a curbside option where you have your trash barrel, but you're placing in your trash barrel two different color bags. One bag is green and one bag is orange. green bag is for food waste, and the orange bag is for garbage. If both those bags go into one barrel, that barrel is then picked up by one truck, taken to another facility where the bags are separated out by color, and then those bags are then loaded on other trucks again, and then delivered to disposal facilities. And Casella did a study of that type of collection several years ago up in Burlington, Vermont. Participation was okay. It was about 50% participation. They were getting it correct. But the bags were breaking in the truck was one issue. What we've seen in Connecticut, the material that I've looked at, the reports from the communities, they're not actually filling the trucks. So it's a term in the trash industry called packing out, where you actually fill the truck. And so we filled the truck when we did our study, and when you filled the truck, the bags break. They're saying they're not seeing broken bags, but their trucks are not full. So they're using more fuel to pick up less material. Again, that whole carbon footprint comes into play. So, but that is something that's out there that's being attempted. What we struggle with is who's separating up those bags. Those are being manually separated. Yeah.
So I know I walked in a minute late and I apologize. But I wondered, so at the town dump,
yep,
if there's a place to put food waste, I don't think there is right now.
No.
Then that's a central location. I mean, everybody's going there to throw out their garbage. Yes. So that's a good place to collect, right? Because
yep.
Then there's no transportation.
So that was one of the things that I suggested was have a drop-off location, use a dumpster.
Mm-hmm.
The town of Mansfield is trying to do food waste composting on site. The town of Stonington does food waste composting at their transfer station. They need a permit, which took 2 years to obtain. And you need to have educated staff on site managing it on an ongoing basis.
Mm-hmm.
So those are two elements that are complicated.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas a dumpster, we can pick that up and take that out. Again, it's a low entry point. The town decides to do something different later. It's a great way to initiate at least the conversation about, hey, you can divert food waste by passing over here. But, you know, just